I want to take you back with me for a minute to December 3rd, 2016. A Saturday that probably doesn't mean anything to most of you, but one that I actually remember very clearly. And that's because I woke up to something like this. Way too many emails for a regular Saturday. Now, my first thought was, what the hell did I do last night? It took me a few seconds to realize that obviously I hadn't done anything, because at the time I was in the final stages of writing up my PhD, and my only two friends were Microsoft Word and my Nespresso machine. So luckily, it wasn't the aftermath of a crazy night out. It was this new story here. The story of a company called Cambridge Analytica, which had created detailed psychological profiles of millions of US citizens during the 2016 presidential election. And they had allegedly used those profiles to target voters with Facebook ads that were highly personalized and essentially designed to discourage them from going to the ballots and putting in their vote for Hillary Clinton. Now, I knew that the article was going to come out, and I knew that it was going to have my name in it. Not because I was in any way related to Cambridge Analytica, I want to make that very clear, but because I was one of the first scientists to study psychological targeting. And I had spent hours on the phone with one of the journalists trying to help him write the story and understand the science behind it. So I knew it was going to come out, but I had no idea that it would literally blow up and become one of the most widely read articles around the world. Now, I don't want to talk about Cambridge Analytica today. And that's just because we simply don't know what actually happened there, and we probably never will. However, what we do know is that the technology of psychological targeting exists, and that more and more companies are using it. And I know that because I get emails almost every single day from people who either want to start a business in that context, or who want to use psychological targeting within their own organization. So instead of wasting my time on Cambridge Analytica, what I want to do is demystify psychological targeting for you by doing three things. I want to explain how psychological targeting works, how effective it is, and most importantly, think with you about how we as a society might want to use it. Because the reason I'm doing this research is not because I want to help companies squeeze every last penny out of their customers. It's because we truly have to understand, we have to develop an objective and scientific understanding of psychological targeting if we want to engage policymakers, business leaders, and frankly, everybody who's willing to listen in a conversation on how to manage it effectively. Okay, so how does psychological targeting work? Which essentially boils down to the question of how can we assess the psychology of millions of people in order to target them with personalized ads? And up to a few years ago, the only way we could measure psychological traits was using questionnaires like this one here, where we'd essentially ask people to tell us how much they agree with different statements, and then based on their responses, we would conclude that they're more extroverted, for example, or more introverted. And this works perfectly well in the context of a research study where you survey a few hundred people, but you can imagine that there's just no way that you can get millions of people complete one of these questionnaires for 10 to 20 minutes before you show them the right ad. So the question is really, if we can't ask people directly, how else can we indirectly glean their psychological characteristics? And the answer is this. We look at their digital footprint. And what I mean by that are all the traces that you leave online on a daily basis. It's what you share and like on Facebook. It's the cookies that keep track of the websites you visit. It's what you post on Twitter, what you buy with your credit card, all the way to what you listen to on Spotify. And you can imagine that all these traces combined can actually tell us a lot about your habits, your preferences, your needs, essentially who you are as a person. So what can we learn about people's psychology by looking at these digital footprints? And I'm just going to show you a few simple but very powerful examples from research of my colleagues and myself in the context of Facebook. Well, you have to trust me that we can get similar insights from pretty much any type of digital footprint that's out there. Okay, so what you see here are the words in people's Facebook posts that are most strongly related to having an extroverted personality. So a tendency to be outgoing and social. And you can see extroverts, they talk about parties, weekends, girls, exciting, so all the fun and exciting stuff that you do with friends. Now, if you contrast that to the words that are most strongly related with having an introverted personality, so a tendency to be more reserved and quiet, you can see that the picture looks very different. So introverts talk about internet, anime, manga, computer, all the stuff that you typically do by yourself. Now, the next one is one of my favorites. It's the words that are most strongly associated with having an agreeable personality, which is a tendency to be caring and trusting. And you can see agreeable people talk about blessed, thanksgiving, wonderful, so there's this warm glow to it. A word of warning, and the word cloud for people who have a disagreeable personality, which means that they're more critical and competitive, looks very different. And we're not cherry picking. So you can do the same thing for the Facebook pages that people can like and follow. And you can see the picture is, again, very intuitive. But most importantly, these very simple relationships between someone's digital footprints and their psychology is all we need to actually apply psychological targeting using existing targeting tools. Because what Facebook, for example, allows you to do is target people not only based on sociodemographic variables like age, gender, location, but also based on interests. And because interests are inherently related to psychological traits, Facebook effectively also allows you to target people or audiences of different psychological profiles. Now, that brings us to the second question. Like, can we really influence people's behavior by targeting them based on their psychological profile? Is psychological targeting really effective? And the answer is yes. And I'm just going to show you the results of one of my studies, but we've tested this in many different contexts, and the results are always very similar. So in this particular case, we teamed up with a beauty retailer in the UK, and we advertised their online store. So our goal was to get women to click on an ad, go to the store, and then purchase something. And we created extroverted ads and introverted ads. So the extroverted ads looked like this one here, and there were several people having a good time, really playing with the need of extroverts to socialize and to be the center of attention. The introverted ads looked different. It was like usually one person in front of the mirror, getting or playing with the need of introverts to have some quiet time for themselves. We then advertised all of the ads to both extroverted and introverted audiences on Facebook using this interest-based targeting functionality that I showed you before. And we measured simply purchases on the beauty retailer's website. And here's what we found. So people in the mismatching conditions, they did purchase, sure, it was advertising, but people in the matching conditions were about 50% more likely to make a purchase. So extroverts were more likely to make a purchase if they saw the extroverted ad, and introverts were more likely to purchase when they saw the introverted ad. And that's pretty astonishing, because this is really the simplest manipulation possible. The only aspect of the user journey that we customized was the ad that people saw. And we used a relatively crude measure or approach to profile people. There's algorithms, machine learning algorithms out there today, and that do a much better job at profiling people and are much more accurate than what we have followed here in this case. One of my colleagues, for example, showed that computers are roughly as accurate at predicting your personality as your spouse is, just by looking at your Facebook likes. They're better than work colleagues, they're better than friends, and they're better, even better than family members. So if you compare what we've done here to what the future is likely to hold, psychological targeting really is only going to be more effective in the years to come. And even that, I think, is really just the beginning of something much bigger. Just look at this comparison here. Like the election of the Pope in 2005 and the election of the Pope in 2013. So you are all carrying around your smartphones almost 24/7, which means that you can be tracked almost continuously in real time, and that one can not only make inferences about your psychological traits, but also the mood you're in, the place you're in, the context you're in. So you're no longer just an extrovert, you're now an extrovert who's currently in a good mood, having a good time with friends in a park. And even that pales in comparison to what I think the future is going to hold. At some point, we probably have chips in our body that measure our physiology. Are we going to wear contact lenses like these ones, which not only capture everything that's happening around you, but also shape your perception of reality by displaying hyper-personalized content to you? Which means that my reality at some point might be entirely different to yours. So if we consider all of this, it's not really surprising that the public's initial reaction to psychological targeting in the context of Cambridge Analytica was a very negative one. Some media outlets have even gone as far as calling psychological targeting a threat to democracy. Now, I want to pause for a second and consider a different scenario. Let's imagine that not Donald Trump, but Hillary Clinton had used psychological targeting in her campaign. And not to create fear, and not to discourage people from voting, but to actually encourage them to engage. Like trying to truly understand what they care about, and to communicate with them in a way that makes them want to be part of the political landscape again. I'm sure that the public perception would have been a very different one. Now, my point here is that psychological targeting isn't evil per se. It's really about how we use it. So as much as psychological targeting can pose a threat in the wrong hands, it could also provide a solution to what, in my opinion, might be an even bigger threat to democracy. And that's disengagement. Like, if 40% of people in the US decide to stay home and not vote, then this defeats the very idea, the very notion of democracy, where everybody engages. And because psychological targeting really is all about understanding and engaging with people on a personal level, I think it could actually help us save democracy. Now, we might collectively decide that we don't want psychological targeting anywhere near our democratic process, and that's okay. Because elections are really just one context out of many in which psychological targeting could be valuable and could act as a catalyst for social good. My students and I are currently working on a number of projects where we're using psychological targeting to try help people live better lives. So for example, we're trying to help people save more by identifying personalized saving goals. We're also trying to help young people find fulfilling careers by having job recommendations that match their psychological motivations. And we're trying to help people who suffer from depression or other mental illnesses to get the personalized support they need by identifying and detecting symptoms early using smartphone sensing technology. And this is really just a snapshot of what's possible. The list here is almost endless. So what I hope that you take away from this talk today is really that psychological targeting is a new reality. It's out there and it's effective. And for me personally, this is as exciting as it is scary, because psychological targeting really provides amazing opportunities, but it also poses some pretty serious challenges. So what that means is that we all have to engage in the topic. We all have to advocate for an ethical use, and we all have to show the people who have the power to make decisions and drive change that we care. Thank you. Thank you.